for those of us in medicine, but particularly those of us in infectious diseases, I feel like this is our dragon to slay. You know, this is a pandemic, it's an infectious disease, and we really need to be leveraging all of our available talent and resources to getting out from underneath this as a community. So I feel so much meaning in the importance of what we're doing right now. So if somebody asks me to do something in response to this, I'm going to say yes, because I think we just need to be doing everything we possibly can and keep the pedal to the floor when it comes to saving lives right now.
If you are living in Nashville and working at a restaurant that is now delivering food, and your children aren't in school and you don't have access to daycare, but you need to go to work, and all of those factors for an individual are important, but they're also important in the community context. So if you live in a neighborhood that you can't get Grubhub restaurants to deliver to you, or you don't have access to grocery stores, or your children are missing meals because they used to eat at school, your concern about COVID is probably less about whether or not you're going to get infected and more about how your family's going to survive. And in a pandemic, I think it highlights the true intersectionality, where all these different factors meet and how an individual might respond differently or might need different information.
Trying to make sense of COVID-19's toll is a nearly overwhelming task. In its short time among the human population, the new coronavirus has upended almost all facets of life in almost every corner of the globe. While some people retreated into new work-from-home routines, and others found themselves in jobs deemed essential, a patchwork of plans was deployed across the country to stagger the impact of this disease to which no one has immunity. Now, months after its arrival, it's clear that COVID-19 is a sift that's revealing discrepancies in how modern institutions respond to a health crisis that is striking both indiscriminately and disproportionately. You're listening to Vanderbilt Health DNA, Discoveries in Action. I'm your host, Clark Buckner. The path to better health lies in our DNA. Discoveries in Action is about the big ideas and breakthroughs happening right here in Nashville, Tennessee, from Vanderbilt Health. Our drive to discover, care, learn, and share, it's in our DNA. It defines who we are, just as your DNA defines you. In this episode, we'll hear from three Vanderbilt University Medical Center experts, Drs. David Aronoff, Consuela Wilkins, and Alex Jahangir, who are entrenched in the response around Nashville, throughout Tennessee, and beyond. They're part of a group who've pivoted their focus to contain a viral threat. As you may remember from our episode on vaccines, researchers right here in Nashville are among those searching for pathways to antidotes and treatments. And you may recall how Dr. Jeff Balzer, president and CEO of Vanderbilt University Medical Center, discussed how COVID-19 is diversifying how the system thinks about personalized care. As COVID-19 shattered customs, schedules, and routines, an awareness emerged that the virus would leave an imprint far beyond 2020. Dr. David Aronoff, director of the Division of Infectious Diseases at the UMC, described how he thinks about the pandemic.
Oh, there's absolutely no question that the COVID-19 pandemic has shifted the globe. I mean, this is really tectonics that we're talking about here. This is the Black Plague. This is the influenza pandemic of 1918. I mean, think about the children born now, and think about the children who are now doing preschool and grade school and elementary college through the computer now. This is absolutely changing our ways of life. I don't know if I will ever again shake somebody's hand, for example. Travel is going to be very different. So I can't imagine that this will not leave an indelible mark on just about every facet of our future. This pandemic, if it ended today, would reverberate, I think, potentially for centuries in terms of the way that it's changing human interaction, the way that we work. I think we're going to find a lot of office buildings empty as people are now working from home, the ways that we find meaningful interaction. And again, that's, for me, one of the most motivating reasons to get up every day and come in and be part of this response against the COVID-19 pandemic. And for us, in my lifetime, I've not experienced something of this suddenness and magnitude, period.
Physicians and researchers faced an Everest-sized task, motivating people to change their behaviors while scientists raced to understand the particulars of this new coronavirus. Dr. Aronoff realized the only way to slay his mythical dragon was to get people to accept, on a dime, new ways of navigating their lives.
I have gained a whole new respect for people who have been involved in public health for a long time and have been trying to get people to change behaviors in such a way to improve their health. So, for example, campaigns to help people stop smoking, or campaigns to help make sure people get their immunizations. This is really, really hard work. And I think we try to meet people where they are. We try to put things into context that they understand. When it comes to COVID-19, a lot of what we're asking of people are pretty major changes to the way that they operated before the pandemic, asking people to stay home. That puts such unique stresses on people and can create fear. Asking people to wear masks when initially the messaging was you didn't have to wear masks. And now changing that messaging and trying to get buy-in for that can be very, very challenging. And trying to help people understand why sometimes guidelines change and recommendations change. I think this is all really still a work in progress. I think the issue here is that we don't really have a lot of time. We have a pandemic that right now is tearing through our communities. It is infecting people, causing a lot of illness, causing death. And we know what we need to do, not only to slow the spread of the pandemic, but to really protect people from getting infected.
Overnight, researchers and scientists found themselves in high demand. People clamored for ways to stay healthy and beacons of hope that a treatment or vaccine was waiting. All of a sudden, minute revelations in science and medicine were the marquee news as people soaked up information about antibodies, ICU delirium, and transmission rates. Dr. Balzer explains that the challenge is using words and metaphors that anybody can understand without dumbing anything down.
I've never seen more nerdy scientists and physician scientists like me spending time on national TV. It's kind of like, wow. We've become a reality show. You know, we all professions get used to talking within the profession, and we use acronyms that nobody understands and language that, you know, we barely understand. And I think we are being forced to use words and examples and stories and metaphors that anybody can understand. And, you know, that's not dumbing it down. I think that's smartening it up. Because if you can explain something technical to somebody outside of your field in a way that they can understand it, it means you understand it better. And I think that that's what we've been called to do during this pandemic. And the more effectively we can do that, the more credibility we have with the public and the more likely they are to respond the way we want and need them to. When people ask me where they should wear a mask, my answer is they should wear a mask anywhere that they're not allowed to smoke. It's super easy to remember, right? It's our job to help people with things like that. That's why they call us professionals. And it's not because we learn acronyms in medical school that nobody understands. So I'm really sort of demanding that we as a profession find language that makes us relevant.
You know, in the same way that this virus is quite literally going viral, so does information. And we know that, of course, we have that whole metaphor of something going viral. And so I think it's important to know that every interview that I do or every story that gets told from what I'm communicating out has that capacity to ripple through and affect people, and hopefully in a positive way.
Soon after the pandemic made it here to Nashville, this became clear. A one-size-fits-all message would not fit a medley of communities. Early data from the first 18,000 people tested for COVID-19 revealed an outsized impact on the city's immigrant and refugee residents. Referencing patient data collected in electronic health records, Dr. Consuelo Wilkins found that people who preferred a language other than English accounted for 5% of all tests done. But when results came back, that same small group accounted for 20% of the positive COVID tests. For VUMC, which is integrating genetic and other relevant information into electronic records, COVID-19 showcased another urgent element of personalized care. Dr. Wilkins, Vice President for Health Equity at VUMC, talks about her charge to lead a health equity component of the pandemic response.
I was actually surprised to find that there were more inequities among people for whom English was not their primary language. And that's in part because many of the reports around the country had focused on the, you know, really shocking and striking disparities among African Americans and Latinx populations, and not as much of an emphasis on the language. And certainly we have had concerns about fewer African Americans in Nashville, given some of the more segregated communities in Nashville, that there would be more disparities among African Americans. And so, again, initially I was thinking that we would see more African Americans or a higher percentage of African Americans being affected in our Vanderbilt data. And it's interesting to think about how to approach this pandemic, given the real diversity of communities that we have in Nashville, but also, you know, of course, around the world. And we tend to think about diversity in terms of race, ethnicity, and not necessarily around some of those other social, cultural factors. And in a pandemic, I think it highlights the true intersectionality, where all these different factors meet and how an individual might respond differently or might need different information. And so how people actually process information in the setting of a crisis, when the crisis isn't all about the infection for them and protecting themselves. And that's hard for some people to actually imagine, that, you know, preventing the infection is not the top priority for some people who are losing their jobs and don't know how they're going to pay their rent and can't get their children connected to Wi-Fi so they can participate in, you know, remote learning. So there are lots of things that we have to consider as far as what people need and how they consume information, their literacy level, their health literacy level, you know, whether or not they believe the health system and the public health agencies or the government are trustworthy, also factors into whether or not people are ready to consume information. Even if they understand it, they may not be ready to act on it.
Persuading communities to take drastic measures to protect themselves and their neighbors is a tough sell. Life as we knew it ground to a halt. And as we've heard from Dr. Aronoff, he thinks the ripples will reverberate far into the future. Yet, as we've explored the loud but small group of people throwing skepticism onto vaccines and the swift growth of COVID-19, it's evident that success requires confidence in both the expertise and the motives of public officials and leaders. And not only is that a tall order in America right now, But for several minority groups, particularly the African American community, medical experts are regarded with reserve and caution.
An often overlooked component here is the factor of trust. And I like to change it, though, and reframe it as the trustworthiness of organizations and providers and health systems and public health programs, because it's been well documented that racial and ethnic minorities are less likely to trust health systems and research programs. And think about that in the setting of a disease for which there's no proven effective treatment. And initially, the most promising treatments were only available through research. And so we have groups of people who've been historically abused and marginalized in the research setting. In the not so distant past, there are certainly many people who are still alive who in the 60s experienced healthcare very differently. There were different entrances for Blacks versus whites and segregated care. So we're talking about this really long-standing distrust that many communities have of the health systems. And during this pandemic, where there's so much information is changing quickly, they don't know how trustworthy the information is, in part because they're not as trusting of the existing systems. And instead of, in many ways, the health systems and the public health programs focusing on how they can be more trustworthy, we have more of saying, you know, they just need to trust us. And so while we're trying to actually build this trust and be more trustworthy, we're also sharing all of this information about how disproportionately impacted minority communities are. And while that's been really great, I, as someone who's studied this and been involved in it for a while, have been so excited that there's been this emphasis here. But some of the emphasis has been seen, if you're in a minority community and they're talking about you, and you're seeing people you know and love die, and there's no proven effective treatment, all you're hearing at some point is that we're just dying and I'm tired of hearing about it. And there are no real options for how this is going to get better. And I think that can make people even less trusting. And so, the conspiracy theories that, many people will say, well, that's just ridiculous for people to imagine that, having a test for the coronavirus could actually give you the coronavirus. But again, we're talking about groups who, in the not so distant past, were abused and were, treatments were withheld. It's not implausible in their minds that this could still be happening. And so instead of us actually working to have more transparency and dedicate ourselves to collecting data, sharing it, coming up with action plans, and not just talking about how horrible it is, we should not be surprised that they don't trust us.
Dr. Wilkins' response resonates with Dr. Alex Jahangir, director of the Division of Orthopedic Surgery at Vanderbilt. Dr. Jahangir has spent the bulk of 2020 in the public eye, talking to Nashville and its surrounding counties about the city's efforts to test, trace, and respond to the spread of COVID. As the chair of Nashville's Metro Board of Public Health, he was asked to lead the Metro Nashville COVID-19 Task Force. He and the city's sizable healthcare industry couldn't solve COVID alone. To keep hospitals from being inundated and to protect the metro area from widespread contagion, he and others had to persuade bewildered citizens to take necessary but hard actions. At times, the results were mixed. After a while, people itched to get back to normal, and masks turned out to be a lightning rod.
Kind of one of the parts of being the physician I cherish so much is that ability to develop that trust with someone. And in medicine, especially in trauma, often I meet people and they've given me the amazing privilege of operating on them and really taking them through a hard time of their life. So I've always cherished that trust and value it greatly. So for me, it's people, especially in moments of crises, especially healthcare crises, really just want somebody that they know that is being honest with them, that's being transparent with them, and has their best interest at heart. And so over the years, hopefully as a physician, I've learned to develop that on a one-to-one basis. So the challenge for me is, how do you translate that into now a community of 700,000? And it is a really, it's very humbling for me. And I value and greatly appreciate the trust that the people of Nashville have placed in me. And I don't want to ever lose that trust, because my interests are the same as theirs. I just want to get on with our community and allow us to have the opportunity to get back to our life. And I'm raising my kids here. I grew up in this community. My parents live here. We all just want to get through this. Now, when it comes to individual success, I think the question is, how is the message being received, right? I think one thing I've learned in my very short public life is how I sometimes think the message is being projected is not how the message is being received. And so I think measuring success is not a straightforward answer. And you're right. I think part of our job is to try to inform people how to know what they do, because there's no way one person or one group of people can control 700,000 people in the city. And this is not a problem that needs one person to deal with. Every one of us has a responsibility to deal with here. And we can only bring success and completion of this if everyone in this community, from me and my formal role, to you and you guys as part of the medical center, to the person who is at home self-quarantining, everyone has a responsibility.
Like many of his colleagues, he's added a ton of Google search results to his name with the media he's done, from interviews to sometimes daily press conferences. He catapulted from the man who had rushed to the operating room to save your life to the man charged with being the public face of a citywide effort to protect Nashville from COVID-19. Even an 11-year career in trauma surgery doesn't prepare you for managing a city's response to a global pandemic.
There's been a few times when I have been overwhelmed. I'm not immune to recognizing this is a really big moment in history. And occasionally, you don't be right, not often, but occasionally I've had time to reflect, and it is pretty overwhelming. So I want to be very clear that this is not, I'm not any more different than anyone else, right? And I remember the very first day we implemented the Safer at Home order, early March, I was driving to the Office of Emergency Management, where we do a lot of our work, and I just drove down 12 South, and it was completely empty. And it really brought me to tears, which is not something I do typically. I'm not usually a crier, if you will. But so I want to first preface this saying that I'm not immune to the stress of what this is. Now, with that said, I also recognize the importance of what we're doing here. I grew up in this community. This community gave me so much when I first immigrated from Iran to Nashville. I graduated from high school here. I've been back here and now have three kids I'm raising. My parents live here. My grandmother still lives here. My brother lives here. And so if I can serve in this capacity and help our city get through this and help Mayor Cooper and help all our great professionals and health systems, then what an amazing opportunity I have to serve. And I will put my 110% into this, because this is what I'm supposed to do. And this isn't about me. And so if I'm a little tired, I'm a little emotional every once in a while, or a little under the pressure from the media or from council members, it's okay. Because if I'm being honest about what we're doing, if I'm being transparent, and if I'm willing to accept when we're right and wrong, then that is what the people of Nashville want and need right now. And that's what I've committed to do. So that's what drives me.
The pressure of crisis has a tendency to accentuate existing gaps. And when the brute force of COVID hit the systems that underpin our society, those cracks turned into active fault lines. Jobs gone, people lost health insurance, the ability to keep schools open became a question mark. But people still had to pay rent, buy groceries, and contend with an invisible, potentially deadly disease. These realities are rumbling through healthcare, underscoring the urgency of action and collaborative solutions. The summer of 2020 unearthed disparities, leaving leaders like Dr. Jahangir and Dr. Wilkins tackling a monumental public health crisis on behalf and with people from whom the threat of COVID might be secondary to the hustle to survive.
They don't have the ability to socially distance in their house because they have multiple people living in a small apartment. These are people that have to go to work or else they'll get fired. These are the people who don't have access to healthcare, and so they may die at home once they're infected with COVID. Or these are people that don't realize the signs and symptoms to get tested. And there's this whole health disparities part of it that has been even heightened further. I mean, health disparities is not something new to COVID, right? I mean, this is something, health disparities in our country has been going on for hundreds of years. And so that part of it is highlighted as well. And I think what is a fascinating experiment to maybe see at some point, because with COVID right now, every treatment's paid for. How does having universal healthcare for treatment of COVID impact mortality and inequalities in our health system? And how can that then be a lesson learned and translated to the future of healthcare? So those are things that those communities don't have the opportunities I have. That's also something I've seen in this role that I probably would never have seen if I stayed in my little bubble of, my little corridor here.
So if we're thinking about life before the first case arrived in Tennessee as BC, before COVID, what could the AC look like? Experts around the world are feverishly working to make sure we get there. So we ask these physician scientists to look forward to the after COVID.
In addition to COVID-19, which I would certainly say is the acute issue that we're trying to address, but the longstanding issue around racism and racial inequity is something that our team has been working on for some time also. And, given the heightened awareness of some of the racial inequities, we are in this unique opportunity to, I think, move forward a few things that haven't gotten people's attention in the past. I would say that about COVID as well. So when we create this information, we have to make sure that it's relevant to them. And we can't say, when you go home, take off your clothes in the garage and put them in a bag and change and then immediately put them in the hot water in the wash machine and turn on the temperature to hot, very hot, because they may not have a car, they may not have a garage, and they may not have a washing machine. So what is the message to them? How do they protect themselves? So I think some of those nuances really get to what I would say the bigger issue around equity that we have is that there's so many things baked into the system that we don't recognize and need to start to dismantle. So we focus on this, the tip of the iceberg, the things that are clearly wrong, the things that have to do with interpersonal communications, but we haven't really gotten down to the foundation of why we have some of these inequities to start with. And so I'm both energized about the opportunity to do the work, but still, grappling with that we're not doing it well right now. I am definitely still energized. I'm at times a little more energized. I would say I'm probably operating at a little more energized. No, this is our chance. We have to do this.
This pandemic is teaching everybody a lot. Undoubtedly, this will help us prepare for potential next pandemics, and hopefully in such a way that we will mitigate the damage that's done by any future pandemics. It's also, though, revealing problems in our healthcare system. It's revealing inequalities in our healthcare system. It's showing us racial biases and issues that really go fairly deep in the fabric of our country and in the way that we deliver healthcare in the United States and around the world. And so this pandemic, like a lot of infectious diseases, quite effectively helps us to see health disparities and problems in our social fabric that sometimes other health problems aren't able to reveal so much. And I think in the history of humanity, we've seen where large-scale disruptions provoked by infectious diseases have revealed problems that can then be hopefully addressed. And it's really my hope that coming out of COVID-19, that there's a lot of problems that get greater attention that end up helping not only human health, but humanity.
Thanks for listening to Vanderbilt Health DNA, Discoveries in Action. On our next episode, we'll examine the field of biomedical informatics and discuss how the collection and analysis of an individual's genetic data, combined with innovations in medical technology, are paving the way for the future of personalized medicine. Until then, you can learn more about the show, check out episode extras, and find out more information about Vanderbilt Health and today's experts at listendna.com. You can also find us on Twitter at VUMC Insights and on all of your favorite platforms at Vanderbilt Health. And of course, don't forget to subscribe, rate, and review the show anywhere and everywhere you get your podcasts, like Apple Podcasts, Google, and Spotify. We're there. Until next time, Vanderbilt Health, making healthcare personal. As a reminder, Vanderbilt Health DNA Discoveries in Action is an editorialized podcast from Vanderbilt Health that isn't meant to replace any form of medical advice or treatment. If you have questions about your medical care or health, please consult your physician or care provider.